The Out of Bounds Show podcast is powered by the DeWalt Tools at Ace Bolt and Screw. Visit acebolt.net for a location near you.
KS Pickens Jackson.
All systems go.
Live from the Whiskey 61 Lounge inside the Bank Plus Studio.
It's now in order.
Live in the studio. It's the Out of Bounds Show with Bo Bounds.
Streaming live worldwide on the Out of Bounds radio app.
And on your radio at ESPN 105.9.
All set. Let's go.
The Zone.
Did we play the cool intro? I just put on my headset. Awesome. Well, that's good. Hope everybody enjoyed that. It's good to be back in the Bank Plus studio. And I want to say good morning. Hope you're doing well. Thanks for making us your SEC football show of choice and sports and entertainment show of choice. There was some sports and entertainment going on at Pearl River Resort Dancing Rabbit Golf Club the last couple of days. Welcome in. Good morning. Hope you're doing well. You're listening to 105.9 The Zone, ESPN, WRKS. Got Blake Mania with me. I'm your host, Bo Bounds. The show is powered by the Golden Moon Casino Sportsbook and award-winning Dancing Rabbit Golf Club. A couple different ways that you can hit us up today. Hit us up on the Farm Bureau Insurance call-in line. We're going to flip back after a week and go to 601-707-3750. Twitter handle, at Bo Bounds. Brought to you by Ace Bolt and Screw, powered by DeWalt Tools. And your Mississippi Ag John Deere Tractor text line, 601-885-3776. We're streaming live on the Out of Bounds radio app. We've got a couple of guests lined up for you today. Several fun topics. Hope you're doing well. Tuesday, as we head into... What, is this a Taco Tuesday, Blake?
Always.
Okay, cool.
Every Tuesday is a Tito's Taco Tuesday.
Yes.
Alliteration.
Yes, no doubt. Hey, I just want to share with everybody that for the last 8 months, I've been asking Blake to... fix the counter. We have a bar in this studio. I don't think that's going to surprise anybody. But so we've got this area in the studio where you can hang out. And we have people up here all the time, especially pre-COVID. But now we've got people coming in left and right, which is pretty awesome. And so this part, what would I say? The side of it?
Yeah, it's the corner of, like, the countertop enamel.
Yeah, and so I've almost cut myself, which would have probably meant I would have bled to death. And
Workers' comp, baby.
Yeah, I'll sue my own LLC. And can I do that? Anyway, let's see. And Blake finally comes up here with some, what kind of, was that Gorilla Glue or something, man? I don't know what it was.
Oh, no, it was industrial wood glue.
Oh, industrial wood
glue. That's homemade.
And when I come up here, I don't remember what I was doing. Sunday, I rolled through here to grab a couple of things for the remote, and Blake has a chair up against it and a ball of glue out. He's not here, obviously, but I can tell that he's, you know, trying to get it fixed. So we're not going to hurt any of our clients or friends that come up anymore. And our
it's officially fixed.
Our bar is officially fixed on a Taco Tuesday. Yeah.
Done.
Did you just move the chair today?
Yeah. Okay. I guess I did that Friday.
Okay.
And, or Thursday. Thursday or Friday of last week. So I just propped it up and left it on there.
For several days, I guess that worked out.
Minimum like 30, 45 minutes is what you want to clamp it.
Is that what you learned in the world of Eagle Scout, or is that what it said on the bottle of the glue?
It's what this person who made this glue told me.
Okay. All right. Well, cool.
Yeah.
What do you think? Do you think the people who sell that glue, do you think they sell enough to be millionaires?
No, he's a millionaire for other reasons. But this
things.
This is a guy that, yeah, just made this. He worked at Calmaine for 50 years.
Oh, well, he's got a great ESOP.
He's a dude that, this is how you know this wood is like legit, because he has like a shed the size of this, but two stories shots of and he like
so you got like homemade glue.
Yeah, he built this stuff.
This isn't Home Depot glue.
No. This is stuff,
this is homemade.
Yeah. This guy chews
with
cigars.
A Mississippi.
He's like real Mississippi.
Okay, like he burned bark.
Yeah,
to make this glue.
He takes like cigars, bites off half of it, sticks it in his chaw, and like chews on it all day and spits
that, that
it.
That
like,
sounds not.
It's
awesome.
Hardcore Mississippi, like redneck, like
yeah. So does this guy eats after he eats a pork chop? He eats the bone.
Yeah, correct.
Okay,
he builds things all the time. Like he's built incredible stuff.
Really,
real hands on woodwork hunter.
Like
does all that
big
stuff.
Big sheds and stuff.
Yeah, builds all kinds of things. Yeah.
Guys buy land, then they buy. The first thing that you do when you buy land in Mississippi is you have to build a big shed.
Shout out to
and then you go and get a bunch of UTV ATV stuff.
Yeah,
because that kind of means you're serious.
Yeah, he's amazing.
Who? Shout out to who?
John Walton.
Okay. Did he just call?
No.
Okay.
DJ wants to talk about Tom Luganville. You already got people fired up.
Oh, good. Good. I didn't know if it was Deion Sanders. I have some stuff on that today. I have some stuff on Matt Corral. I think we put something together on Jimbo Fisher, Les Miles, Ed Ogeron, Gene Chizik. Is there really any difference in any of them?
Oh.
I've got all kinds of stuff.
Be hot take.
Thank you very much. Good morning. In The Athletic, one of the subtopics of an article is, and I quote, this is air quotes. Like,
okay, so this is official.
Yeah. Matt Corral is a treasure. All right. So that's something else, too, that I can dive into. And then, of course, we've got some baseball series. The It's Too Toxic rivalry will continue on. And they will play this weekend, and that would be Mississippi State hosting Ole Miss.
Get that guy drunk. I bet he'd fight everybody.
Yes. Yes. No question. No question.
You're telling me it's going to be a
good
weekend?
Who would that be on each team?
Who would?
Mississippi State and Ole Miss. Who drop that line again. Tell our caller to hang on.
Get that guy drunk. I bet he'd fight everybody.
Okay.
All right. Immediately, I think Wes Burton for Ole Miss, just because of the way he pit. You know, he talks to himself and he's all
fair enough,
angry looking, and Pitching Ninja has highlighted that, which I think is great for the game.
And who's for MSU? Is it Tanner Allen?
Logan Tanner looks like someone who, if you got into a bar fight, could take about six people.
That's true too.
He is built like someone who you would run into in the sticks, like. At a honky tonk.
Like when you take a left, a right, and a couple another more lefts, left. And another right off 49.
Yeah. And you pull over for beer and it's like real dusty.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like that.
And they're just waiting to kick somebody's ass.
Yeah. Tommy says Cale Baker. That's the first baseman with the long locks on Ole Miss's team.
Okay.
He's built like a tree trunk. He is round.
Built like a tree trunk.
There
was some dudes out there on Dancing Rabbit Golf Course that were built like a tree trunk that were playing around us. All right. Who am I going to?
DJ is upset maybe about your Tom Luganville
DJ
interview.
DJ is on the Farm Bureau Insurance call-in line. DJ, good morning. What's happening?
Hey, thanks for taking my call. And listen, I understand bias, but I do want to correct some unfactual statements by Luganville. First of all, his statement that Fields has struggled in big games, that's laughable. Last year, they played five top 10 teams. He threw for 40-something touchdowns and three picks.
Hold on. I understand that they've got to rank people in the top 10, but the Big Ten didn't have five top 10 teams. So go ahead.
You can check that. We played five top 10 teams.
Okay, well, just because you're ranked in the top 10 doesn't mean you're a top 10 team is my point.
Okay, well, I get that, but I'm talking about when we played.
Okay, good enough.
40-something touchdowns, three picks. All right, this year, you saw the Clemson game. Was that not the best quarterback performance of the year in one of the biggest games of the year?
It was.
Okay. Now, let me address the so-called two bad games. In Indiana, we were up 35-14. He threw for almost 400 yards. He had three picks. The Northwestern game, so-called, his two bad games were Indiana Northwestern. We had 22 guys out for COVID, so we ran the ball and won the game going away. So, you know, the thing is, I don't mind you being biased against
me. All right, sorry, I've got to go to break, so you got to call back at some point. But so he's all in on Justin Fields at Ohio State. The show is presented by Mississippi Sports Medicine, an orthopedic center. Visit MississippiSportsMedicine.com. Back in a sec. The Out of Bounds Show podcast is brought to you by Boar's Head. Premium meats, cheeses, and hummus. Boar's Head. Compromise elsewhere.
What's on the big board? What's on the big board?
Julian Edelman retires, New England Patriots wide receiver. 118 receptions, 1,442 yards in the postseason. Incredible. Incredible. Julian Edelman. What a little baller. Ryan Fowler's up. He's told me he could go early. I don't know what we want to do there.
Do a full hour of Ryan Fowler? Is there anybody that could do 24 hours of Alabama radio?
Yes, Ryan Fowler.
Ryan Fowler.
He does a 4 or 5 hour show every day.
It's 4 hours.
Is it?
But remember he talked about how after the national title, he didn't go to sleep and he did an extra. They did like a 4 hour post game and then he got up and did another 4 hour radio show.
Oh, yeah.
He was like, we did this long post game till like 1 a.m. and then I stayed awake all morning and then got up and did my show.
No, he jumped on an alum's plane.
That's right.
From San Francisco back to Tuscaloosa.
So he could do his show.
He kind of got, you know, hooked up, so to speak.
Well, when you're the Ryan Fowler.
And so he had a direct from San Fran to T-Town and he took it. That was when they got beat by Clemson. And, you know, it was like a funeral, told me, for a year.
Yes, but I mean, I'm talking about from this national title when he said he was up all night. Did their big post-game explode, you know, radio show of winning, and then did his show from the next day winning.
Do you think Ryan Fowler could do 4 hours on why Mac Jones deserves to be the number three pick in the NFL draft?
Number one. Don't sell him short.
That's right. Mac Jones should after watching, because Alabama won all their games, right? Because this is the way sports fan. Because Alabama won all their games.
Correct.
And they won a national championship.
Correct.
That means that Mac Jones should be picked ahead of Trevor Lawrence.
Obviously.
Okay.
Josh said, that caller sounded like the typical Bama fan. You can't critique our quarterback. Let me tell you how great he is. I bet you if Ryan got on the air and said, hey, Trevor Lawrence is number one, but Mac Jones is number two in this draft, there would be an overwhelming majority of fans who call for his resignation. Said, Ryan, you've gone soft. You're hating on the Tide too much. Mac Jones is number one. You need to get off air.
Right, right.
That's the commitment level.
San Francisco's not taking Mac Jones.
No chance. I'll stake everything I have on it.
I was listening to John Middlecoff yesterday again, San Francisco sports media, and was an NFL scout. And he just said, I don't see San Francisco trading up like that to take Mac Jones.
I stick him the middle finger. There's no way I'm doing that.
For our listeners, he's the Bama QB.
Who?
Well, he followed Tua, and I'm just not sure how many people really knew who Mac Jones was past year.
And yet,
I mean, he's like plain toast. I mean,
Was Tua better than Mac Jones? I mean,
no. But Tua was overrated.
Isn't there?
It's just hard for people to wrap their brain around. Is Tua a heck of an athlete and a good quarterback and skilled and more so than most anybody we know that's listed? Yes.
But so is Mac Jones in that term.
But Tua is not special.
Yeah.
But he was supposed to be. He's got an awesome name. He played for Bama.
He did the walk-off
in his freshman year.
One big pass.
And he never really got back. It's like Shea Patterson. He was what he was when he stepped on campus. And people struggle with that.
Yep.
I mean, and it just happens. Some guys are done in 11th grade or 12th. Well, I mean,
Whose career would you rather have? Tua's or Mac Jones's? Knowing right now, forget whatever happens moving forward in the NFL. Mac Jones is going to be drafted in the first round. We know that. So, assuming they both were first-round draft picks, which they will be, Tua was, Mac Jones will be, taking that part and forgetting what else happens after this, whose career would you rather have? Tua's, where you have the walk-off and then in theory everything is downhill after that. Or Mac Jones, who doesn't see the field until his one season and has the Cinderella perfect season.
Matt Jones probably has a chance to play longer in the NFL. But are you just talking Alabama alone?
I'm saying from when they got to Alabama to when they're drafted in the first round, whose career would you rather have?
You'd rather have the walk-off.
Really?
Because the walk-off is what people will romanticize.
You take the one play over the great one season. Interesting.
Because if you're asking me for Alabama fans in their fan base, they think Tua Tagovailoa is the best quarterback
ever to play there.
Yes.
And you think that
even more snow,
and you would
than
hang,
snake and name it.
You'd hang that on the walk-off one. That would be...
No. Well, I hang that on... No. I hang that on the fact that he was a five-star number one guy. Okay. Mac Jones was not. So even before he got to campus, they were telling us they had already... When a fan, any of us, when we decide something is definitive,
hot,
concrete
yeah.
in sports, again, we can't get off... We can't shake it. So... When the kid was in Hawaii as the number one quarterback recruit in the country, they had already decided he will be better than
anyone.
Yeah. Andrew Luck, than Trevor Lawrence, than, you know, any number of people that, you know, you can think. Peyton Manning, right?
Interesting. So if you were picking a career to have, you would take the Tua career over the Mac Jones career, given what
you
they've done up to date.
You asked me kind of what will be remembered for years and years and years within the Alabama fan
base. No. I wanted to know which one would you rather have.
I think you'd rather throw a walk-off in the title game with everything on the line. Okay.
Than just be perfect throughout the season.
I don't think that's how people look at Mac Jones being perfect throughout the season.
Yeah.
I think Devontae Smith and others get way more publicity.
Well, obviously, Devontae Smith, Heisman. So,
I don't think Bama fans... I think they're somewhat enamored, but they're in love with Tua. I mean, Tua will never do this because he won't have to. But again, if he sells insurance in the state of Alabama in Birmingham... Yeah.
They're calling him to get the
And
quote.
I don't even really think he's, wired personality-wise to do that. But, you see where I'm going there. Who's that? Mac Jones?
Mel Kiper has Mac Jones number 3 to the 49ers.
Well, John Middlecoff out of San Francisco, who's got a pretty good read on San Francisco 49ers team and so on, says he does not believe that they're going to do this. So it's going to be interesting to see.
Steve Plazo told us he wouldn't take him at number 3.
Right.
Said he doesn't think
if
that.
If they moved around like this to take Mac Jones,
it might be up there with the Trubisky trade. In terms of terrible first round draft trades.
But that's not who John Lynch and Kyle Shanahan have been the last
and
4 years.
And Kyle Shanahan, as I love Mike D'Antonio's quotes, all of them are hilarious. But the one where he says, well, he's telling you without telling you. You know, he says that about Sean Payton all the time. Well, he's telling you if you listen to him. Kyle Shanahan talks about Josh Allen like a schoolboy talks about his first crush. Is Mac Jones Josh Allen?
Like when you're 15 and you've got the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue?
Like the first time a girl gives you her cell phone number and she's actually interested in you.
Very, very attractive.
That first kiss after a movie, right? Like that's the...
Do people still go to movies?
Well, they used to.
Gotcha.
When I was in high school, that was the thing. Or junior high. But yeah, that's the way Kyle Shanahan has talked about guys like Josh Allen. And Kyler Murray. Mac Jones is not that guy. Trey Lance and Justin Fields and Zach Wilson are those guys.
And Lance has started a whopping 17 games.
Which is incredible. But Daniel Jones got drafted, eighth overall, sixth
How's
overall?
How's that worked out?
No, I'm with you. Mitch Trubisky started one season.
I mean, what do I have at the end of the day with Daniel Jones and Mitch Trubisky? What do I have? Just tell me.
Wasted pick.
I mean,
Mitch Trubisky's not even with the Bears.
What will this be for Daniel Jones with the New York Football Giants?
Year three.
So this is it for Joe Judge and the New York Football Giants.
Would Dak Prescott be starting at Dallas if his first two seasons went the way Daniel Jones?
Absolutely not. He'd be the backup in, somewhere like Minnesota. Ugh. Or Chicago. Well, you can't be the backup in Chicago. They've yet to really have a starter the last 40 years. Detroit. God. did Sean McVay just absolutely kick Jared Goff in the stones or what? I mean, he just basically took him, dragged him out the door with the trash. And seriously, we're back with the SEC Insider Hit next. The Out of Bounds Show podcast is presented by Edwin Watts Golf Shop on County Line Road. Your golf game starts with Edwin Watts Golf Shop.
Do it.
This is the SEC Insider Hit. And it's presented by Blue Cross Blue Shield of Mississippi. It's good to be blue.
Oh, man. Good morning. Welcome in. We are the Out of Bounds Show, 105.9 The Zone, ESPN. And the SEC Insider Hit this morning is brought to you by our friends at Blue Cross Blue Shield of Mississippi. It's good to be blue, the official health care provider of the Out of Bounds Show. Blue Cross Blue Shield of Mississippi. It's good to be blue. We're live in the Bank Plus studio. It's good to be back after a week of travel and doing shows from different places. Starkville, Live Oaks Golf Club, Dancing Rabbit Golf Club, and back in the beautiful, luxurious Bank Plus studio. Want to say good morning to you. Hope you're doing well. We're mixing in some SEC football and NFL draft. And, you know, some other topics today. We want to welcome in our friend and Alabama Roll Tide insider, Ryan Fowler, 109 The Game in Tuscaloosa. And Ryan joins us on the Modelo guest line as we were talking Tua and Mac Jones and some other things in the last segment. Ryan, good morning. How are you, buddy?
Man, I'm great. Get a little A-Day and a little national championship celebration. I was calling out Alabama fans yesterday because, you know, they were talking about, like, well, okay, so are you going to the game? Does A-Day do it for you?
And they were
talking, no. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, that's pretty much what they said.
Is
yeah,
it?
I mean, and so I, yeah.
Bama fans?
Yeah. I mean, it took me 3 hours to get five people signed up to go to A-Day. You think I'm kidding you? I mean, I'm serious as a heart attack. I had more people call in telling me they're going to the softball game with Alabama and Florida, which is like a top five matchup than A-Day. Nice. So about midway through the show, probably about 2.5 hours, 3 hours in, they announced that they were doing a national championship celebration. So it kind of
Did that move the needle a little bit?
A little bit. Yeah, I mean, I think it did. Yeah, because I think there were so many people that. Yeah, but I mean, we were already calling them out that you know, maybe Nick Saban's biggest problem is not the players, because everything coming out of the spring, I mean, Nick Saban's used verbiage that we've never used.
Like,
I
mean, what?
He said, "I'm pleased." Well, like, I'm pleased.
Wow.
With team. You don't ever hear that. I mean, not from Nick Saban. I mean, he said it multiple times this year. So this spring.
What's going on with him? So, is he getting soft?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know.
Can I start with that? Is that me? Can I start that rumor?
Well, yeah, I mean, sure, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I do. I start rumors all the time. Yeah, I mean, so when you look at Nick Saban, I mean, I do think he's changed, because keep in mind, I know media, they want the click, so they call it rants, but we haven't had a Nick Saban full-blown rant in about 2 years. I mean, we have literally been 2 years.
What do you think's going on?
I don't know. I think it's
have you asked people
maybe.
Like close to him that have they answered that or tried to answer that question right, specifically?
Right, so do you remember a couple of years ago when Lane Kiffin was here and there was a call, it was late in the game and Alabama was winning by four touchdowns. And I mean, he just absolutely exploded. It was they were running a jet sweep with like 2 minutes to go, and they fumbled the football.
Yeah.
And Lane, yes, okay. Well, that conversation, his granddaughter, little small granddaughter, said, "Papa, why are you so mad on TV? You were winning so big." And it got him. You know, I mean, you could tell. So maybe that's what it is. Maybe he doesn't want his, grandkids to see that version of Nick Saban. So maybe the grandkids have softened him up in public. But listen, he still is rowdy as everything inside that practice facility.
Sure.
Which, you know, that's when the cameras are off.
Yeah. Okay. Ron Fowler, Tuscaloosa, Bama Insider, 109 The Game. His show, ain't your show like 8 hours a day?
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
I thought so.
Started.
You're the Iron Man. You're the Cal Ripken of Sports Talk Radio.
Well, we do 5 hours on Tuesday. And the only reason we do 5 hours on Tuesday, we do four every day, but five on Tuesday, because Martin Houston, former fullback in 1992, the national championship winning team, him and I partner together. He does mornings here starting at 6 a.m. And so we do a show together for 1 hour on Tuesday night. And it's more of a show that we send out to affiliates where they can play it. It's an hour show. And I don't want to say it's a generic Alabama show, but it's not really like, you know, we don't take a lot of phone calls. It's just, you know, hard hit meat and potatoes because people play it, you know, all throughout the week. I mean, somebody play on Saturday, so we don't say, hey, it's Tuesday night. It's just, you know, we do it Tuesday here, but then we send it out to a lot of different affiliates.
Okay. And what is this guy's name? Fullback? Mark?
Yeah, Martin Houston. He was the second leading rusher behind Derek Lassick in 1992. So Martin is a business guy here in Tuscaloosa, does radio, and is also a pastor. So he's got his hands full, but we're able to work in 1 hour. And
does he look like a fullback? I mean, is he built like a pork chop?
He's kind of like a guard in the backfield.
That's what I thought.
He's one of my best buddies, man. We knock out, I don't know if this is a bad thing, but we knock out Dreamland at least once a week, if not twice. Yeah, I mean, I don't want to make you jealous or anything, but yeah, we're, and so we were already doing it. So we're like, oh, let's put this thing on the
air.
Can
I say something to you? And I need to be honest with you because we've become good friends over the years.
Okay.
I think Dreamland's overrated. And I love you.
Really?
Yeah, I do. I do. I hope you don't hang up on me.
Really?
Yeah. Are you
done? No, I'm not going to hang up. So what is it? Is it the meat or is it is it just the?
Yeah, it's everything. I mean, I've been several times, but I think it's just that it's been around a long time.
Well, let me
it's the nostalgia.
But I think if you got to go with,
do I need to go with you since you're kind of an insider?
Yes, you do.
Okay.
Yeah, because and it all depends on how you order because they're one of our sponsors.
Oh,
and so,
sorry.
So I walk in and you're fine. I'm not only in Tuscaloosa, so, but you talking about me, I can lay down just the bread and sauce.
Okay.
I think a bread and sauce is, but now that's another thing. Okay. You cannot get cold sauce. If that sauce is cold, send it back and ask some like heat temp wise, not spicy wise, because the hotter the temp that sauce is served, the better it is.
Okay.
So you got to go really, really hot sauce.
All right.
And I say hot as in temp and just heat it up a little bit. And then the ribs, there's a certain way that you got to order those. Not just, hey, you know, slap them out there. Mm-hmm. We love the big ends. It's just, you know, there's a lot of meat there. But sometimes we get lazy, too, and you could do, they call it rib and chips, rib tips and chips. It's pretty good, too. But
all right, well, lazy, man, I'm going with you this summer.
Okay, yeah. And have you ever been to the original one with the dirt floor?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, because it's like you walk to where this thing is cooked at, and I mean, not like that, the dining room's not dirt floor, but I mean, it's a pretty, you know,
it's a rustic place for sure.
Yeah. Right. I mean, it may have been there since 1958.
Right. I mean, they haven't put any new paint on the wall in a while.
No.
All right, Ron Fowler, 109 The Game, Bama insider on the Modelo guest line. We're still friends even after I just said that. So
yeah, no, I feel sure, like sure. I mean, well, see that. We need to be a role model for the country. Just because we disagree doesn't mean I have to dislike you.
That's
so,
right.
So like now.
So now we're not going to go to Twitter and get in a fight, right? We're just going to be like, hey, we're still friends.
I can't believe you don't like my place. I can't. No.
All right, let's go to Mac Jones. I'm not trying to like really take shots this morning, but I get the sense that Alabama fans are trying to make him out to be the next Peyton Manning. And, I mean, I think when you really look at him, he's not even close to a first-round pick, but he will be drafted in the first round. How do you see it? You agree or disagree?
Let me tell you where Mac Jones is really, really good. I watched this kid develop. I interviewed him coming out of high school. He had great leadership characteristics then. I think that what he gets you to do is he walks in and he gets the other guys to believe in you. The 10 guys believe in Mac Jones. I was actually, I know this is going to really sound Alabama-ish, but I was rabbit hunting with a former player from this past year. And we were talking about Mac Jones, and he was a teammate, and he said, man, I'll tell you, he said, this guy is the ultimate leader, that he walks in the locker room, and it's not just the offensive guys, it's the defensive guys who respect him. So if you need that guy on your team to rally everybody around you and make those guys better, then he's that guy. And so I went to, and I was like, well, what separates him? He said, that's one. He said, but number two is he spends like 3 hours a day studying tape. So he knows every move that you make. Now, if you ever heard him back in the fall and you'd ask him, say, okay, hey, break down Mississippi State's defense, break down Ole Miss's defense, break down Arkansas. I'm telling you, it's been a long time since I heard a quarterback break down a team. Like, in other words, his was a three-minute answer. Like, he would go, well, you know, 29's pretty good. He likes to slide in a lot, likes to cheat a little bit closer to the line. I mean, he'd break it down, like literally every position on that team. He knew it by heart that he'd already broken down the opponent. That was usually on a Monday when you're asking, hey, you know, you play Mississippi State this weekend. What do you think about their defense? And I mean, it was that's what type of, you know, work ethic that it goes in. I have not heard a quarterback, including Tua, Jalen, Jake Coker, Blake Sims. I got to go all the way back to like A.J. McCarron, Greg McElroy, to hear guys who study that much tape to break it down. But I do think he has a skill set. I mean, you got to remember, Bo, he only started for 1 year
right.
at Alabama. One
that year. Concerns me. And, you know,
but
because
you know how they value quarterbacks, though.
Oh, he's going early. I'm not debating that. It will just be too early. I mean, he's not worthy of a first, much less second round pick, but because of the quarterback.
Look at Dak Prescott.
Okay.
When we were watching him go at Mississippi State, and I respected him, did you think he would be the starting quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys?
Well,
making this type of money?
I mean, I didn't know right then that he'd make $200 million. No, but I knew that he was playing with you know, basically a used Band-Aid and, you know, an old sponge that you find in a sink at a hunting camp. So my point there, Ryan, is that I knew that he didn't have one skill position player that was going to play in the NFL. And I thought he didn't have an offensive lineman that was going to play in the NFL, and he really didn't. See, that to me, and that's not a shot at Mac or Tua or whatnot, but is Dak Prescott better than Mac Jones and Tua Tagovailoa? Yes, by, you know, 1,000 miles. What Dak had to do was literally take the team on his shoulders and lead the way, whereas Bama's so good at every position. Not that Mac didn't make some big plays, but when you're that talented, you don't have to carry the whole load.
No, and listen, I watched Dak Prescott play a ton, not as much as you, but I mean, I watched when, and I always had respect for him. I just, you know, I'm a Dallas Cowboy guy anyway, so I pull for him now. And but you just look at, I mean, the toughness that he showed. I mean, he was like the Energizer Bunny. I mean, he just kept on taking hits. He just kept going and going and going and going. So when you look at Dak, and I never forget when he was asking the pros, he said, was that the hardest you've been hit? He goes, no, I played Alabama 4 years. You know,
well,
it's like,
look at 2015. I mean, I'm surprised he didn't end up in an ambulance. I mean, you know,
great point.
The Mississippi State offensive line was more La Monroe than SEC standards. Okay, and so what Alabama's front did to him that day was, you know, Dan Mullen should have been arrested. But anyway, so Mac Jones. All right, so Tua struggled last year, and there's discussion around, I want to see what you think here, I was listening to some people talk about Tua, and they like him. I know he's a nice kid, but they were talking about how he's passive. He's not really an alpha, that his dad's a big, big personality and kind of led the way for him. And then he played for a coach that obviously sucks all the oxygen out of the room, which isn't a bad thing at the collegiate level. And so he never really had to be the man. And all of a sudden at Miami, you know, he's having a couple of games where he's throwing for under 100 yards, which is hard to do in the NFL this day and age. And he's, you know, slight in stature and so on. What do you think is going on? I mean, do you think he takes a giant step forward, or he may just be a great college player and not a great NFL player, which we see sometimes?
Well, I think he's got an elite arm. I don't think it's as strong. I think Jalen's got the strongest arm out of these three guys. But he just didn't know where it was going all the time. He knew it was going some of the time, but he didn't know where it was going all the time. But I think Tua is doing a couple different things. I think it really would have been wise for Miami is just to set him the entire year. Because I feel there's no way. I think that injury at Mississippi State, I mean, we were talking about there was no way that guy was going to be able to come back and play. And I think he went through rehab, his body healed. So I don't think he was that same player. And I think he gets a lot of power from his legs. You know, he has to. He's not a tall guy, so it's got to come from somewhere. And so I think he gets a lot of that. I mean, if you look at the way he's built, you know, lower portion body, he's just huge. I mean, he's giant down there. So I think he gets a lot of that torque from there. And so I look at Tua. I read the report. I think there was an anonymous player talking to Joe Shad, which is the old college football guy from ESPN.
Sure.
But it was, and they were talking how that, you know, they didn't even believe that he was the guy. I mean, how crazy is that? You got to go in a locker room knowing that you've got a guy that you don't know his name, but that he's willing to talk off record to a reporter that you're not very good. You know, I mean, think of that. That's the difference between college and NFL right there.
Sure.
Is that you get an NFL guy. So those things like that are concerning to me because you wonder – you know, what we were just talking about with Mac Jones, if every, you know, 21 players, offense, defense, buying into what you believe in. I mean, they're 1 year into the pros. Now, that guy may have been traded. He may have been cut. Who knows? He could have had sour grapes.
But if you're the man, I mean, I'll say this, Ryan.
You got to get everybody to respect you.
Yes, right. And if you're the man, then that doesn't happen. And I just don't think he's – I don't think he's got the teeth and the alpha in him. Not that he's not a good young man, whatever. Like – that wouldn't happen to Dak Prescott. He owned that Dallas Cowboys locker room from the minute Romo went down in that exhibition game and ripped up his back. It was Dak's locker room.
Here, let me ask you, and this is a roundabout question. Is Tua too nice?
Yes. It's not his fault. I mean, we all come here a certain way, right? His DNA makeup is one of, I just think he's passive. He's not. You know,
he's a, I mean, as Nick Saban said, he said, Tua's made me polite. I'm over here saying thank you and yes, yes, ma'am. I mean, it's like, I mean, so Tua's just one of those guys that's just like super, super nice. And maybe that does, you know, come across a little bit.
We've watched Brady bark at people on the sideline for 20 years. He's barked at his offensive, everybody but Belichick, but he's barked at his offensive coordinator, wide receivers, linemen. I just think you got to have that bite in you, Ron, to play that position. Look, if you're playing guard or outside linebacker or slot, it doesn't matter. You can mosey into the deal, do your thing, leave. It's all good. When you're QB1 in the NFL, different deal, my friend. You agree?
No, I do agree. I do agree, but I do see that bark. Okay, so write this down. April the 13th, 2021, okay. Bo Bounds does not believe in Tua. Ron does. Put me in the yes category. Let's have this conversation this time next year and see if he has a different season. Because I believe in Tua. I think the kid – now, I believe in Mac Jones maybe more than I do the other two guys. I think Mac Jones is going to have a big career in the NFL. Because I think he has.
Right, I want you to know that will go against the last 20 years of trends. Just FYI, if you track NFL, like guys from Alabama that don't every now and then you have an outlier, but guys at Bama and Ohio State that don't have to carry the team, that don't face a bunch of third and 11s, right? I mean, that literally just, you know, your offense is a first down machine. You got crazy town around you. This will go against the NFL trend if Tua and Mac start both for 10 or 12 years, Ryan. They'll be outliers.
Okay. All right.
Because,
well, I'm going to take the other.
You know, look, Eli Manning from
Hall
Ole Miss.
I'm not saying Hall of Fame.
Sure.
But I'm just saying that I think they'll play at the next level, and I think they'll have some success.
Okay. Well, now that's a different deal. I guess playing at the next level and some success could be like.
Well, okay. All right. Well, how about this?
You know, Fitzmagic or something.
They're a starting quarterback 3-4 years in. Like in other words, they make it beyond, like, you know, next year or the following year, and they're still the starting quarterback. Now, I think Mac Jones is probably a draft and wait type guy. I don't think he's, you know, game number one that he'll be the starting quarterback. I think he would probably be best to wait his turn, and which really didn't happen anymore in the NFL. Kind of, you know, those general managers have got to convince the audience that, you know, what they bought into.
Yeah.
So that you know, that they've got to. So you really believe what you said the other day on my show?
What did I say?
I mean, you got my audience. I mean, man, they're still fired up what you said.
Good.
That Ole Miss is going to come to Tuscaloosa.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. I think they've got an opportunity to win. And I think they're built to beat Bama. Like, if Corral was... had more 50-plus yard passes, right? Number one in college football. And they had 57 plays of 20 or more yards, which ranked fifth nationally. That's the only way you get Bama, Ryan. I mean, you don't get Bama by going 4 and 6 yards down the field, was my point. So the fact that they were elite at explosive plays and they returned that quarterback, and because of Lane, you know, likes to run.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sure.
That gives them an opportunity. Yeah. I mean, should Bama win the game? Yes. But to me, Ole Miss, out of all the teams in the SEC West,
that
Ole Miss has the best opportunity to beat Alabama because of what I just went through as far as 50 plus yard passes and plays of 20 or more yards. That's the only way you can get Bama uncomfortable and on their heels, in my opinion.
Well, you got these guys all stirred up, man. I was at a restaurant. A guy walked up to me. Who's that guy that thought Ole Miss is going to?
I love it. Well, you know, the week of, I may end up predicting. You know, maybe you'll have me on, and I'll just say, who knows? Ole Miss going to win 44-41. I mean, that's how they would have to win it in an absolute shootout. But I don't know about Bryce Young. What do you think? Is he going to be better than – I've only got like 20 seconds. Do you think Bryce Young's going to be like unbelievable or just good?
Well, I mean, I'll say this. Bryce is so good, he's given Nick Saban trouble of not declaring he's the starting quarterback.
Okay.
Like, he's almost said it, but I know you got to get out of here. Hey, man, it's good to talk with you, Bo. Have a great rest of the show and a great rest of the week.
Hey, buddy, we're going to Dreamland soon, okay?
Okay.
I'm glad we're still friends, too, man. All right?
No, we're still buddies. We're still buddies. Have a great day, man.
All right, buddy. See you. Ryan Fowler, 109 The Game, T-Town, Bama, Roll Tide Insider. He joined us on the Modelo guest line. The show is always presented by Blue Cross Blue Shield of Mississippi. It's good to be blue. The official healthcare provider of the Out of Bounds Show. Welcome in. Good morning. On a Tuesday, we are live in the Bank Plus studio. The Mississippi Ag John Deere Tractor text line is 601-885-3776.